So I'll be talking to you about the more about the prehistoric period and slightly overlap with the period which Hemant has already talked to you about. So I'm trying to look at megalithic monuments, prehistoric monuments like this, which you see here, and see if they have any connection with later monuments that you find, like temples and stupas, etc. And considering this important base of heritage that megalithic monuments represent, and considering that that range of distribution covers almost the entire world, want to connect it to the main theme of this conference by seeing whether studying megaliths on a larger geographical canvas will enhance our understanding about these monuments. So if I were asked to sum up my entire lecture, I would take this quote from Colin Renfrew, which appears fairly obvious, but as we move through the ancient landscape which have been occupied by different generations of people, we find that this is all the more true. So if you look at what are the earliest monuments in the subcontinent, probably what you're seeing here, this what looks like a little hill here, is called an ash mound, and they are from the Neolithic or the late Stone Age. And these are basically, they've been created by successive layers of dung from cattle which are domesticated in the Neolithic, and created over large periods of time, and they've been set fire periodically, and they assume the large sizes. Now, opinion is divided whether they were utilitarian constructs, like people were firing the dung for hygienic purpose of hygiene and things like that, or were there monuments, there was a firing ritual and things like that. But whether ash mounds were monuments or not, megaliths certainly were. And this is probably what you can think of as the simplest megalith. It's a slab of stone which has been put erect. It's about 130 kilometers from here, a place called Nilaskal, near Hosnagara. You have this one of the several menhirs which are there in that place. So menhirs may be, in this case, this is also part of a large collection of menhirs. There may be other arrangements like what you see in Sanganakallu, where you have menhirs in a row. It's a Neolithic site which also had a subsequent megalithic phase. Or this place in Kerala, in near Munnar, in the Bison Valley, on the shoulder of a hill called Chokkanmudi, you have megaliths arranged in a row. For what purpose, we really do not know. And in an extreme case, you may have something like the megaliths of Hanamsagar in northern Karnataka, where you have more than 2,500 stones erected in grids, like you can see out here, in a vast area surrounded by low hills. So the menhirs are only one. I'm just trying to show you the diversity of form which is there in megaliths of various kinds. This is a megalithic site in a place called Hirabanakal, which is north of Hampi, which all of you are familiar with. You have a hillside covered with nearly 400 monuments of various types, the largest of which are these dolmens, the dolmens that Hemant was telling you about. These are large enough for us to walk in erect or something like that. And the entire hillside has been covered by lots of monuments like these. Or a similar, very extensive megalithic site exists at a place called Mallasandram near Krishnagiri in Tamil Nadu. So this is an example of a megalith at Krishnagiri. It's quite large and extensive. This is a porthole dolmen surrounded by these slab circles, many of which have fallen and things like that. Okay, so now before I give you an impression that all megaliths are elaborately conceived monuments like this, that's not really true. There are also more cruder looking structures like these. These are basically just small slabs of stone that have been propped up on smaller rocks. And probably when it was complete, all sides were covered with cobbles of stone, so that a chamber is created inside, probably to keep relics of dead people and things like that. And even these are megaliths. This one is at Etrapalli, which is quite close to that Mallasandram which I told you in Krishnagiri. And this is at Aihole, where basically you can see that there's nothing mega about these megaliths. They're quite small in structure. But they are also created within the same system of cultural practice. So that brings us to the question, what are megaliths? Now the word means megathos, the size, the scale of construction and the material, which is basically built of large stones is one way of looking at it. Though as we have seen, they need not be very large, and they may not even contain stone like the rock cut burials of Kerala and things like that. And so initially, before archaeological investigation revealed the true nature of megaliths. People speculated about all kinds of things, whether they were. So this quote from James Ferguson in his in his book, which is a collection of such monuments all over the world, called Rude Stone Monuments. He is wondering whether, you know, people, all kinds of theories that there were law courts and there were temples and there were observatories and things like that. Today we know that megaliths are basically funerary and other monuments of prehistoric cultures. Now the important point is that megalithic is not a period. It is a cultural practice that occurred at different phases in development of human history in different parts of the world. So they may date from Neolithic to the Iron Age. In India, it's believed that they broadly follow the Iron Age, track the Iron Age, and maybe continued into the early historic period. So, they are a world phenomenon. Megaliths is a world phenomenon. And this is something that I will return to at the end of the lecture if I have time. You find it all over the world. In fact, you find them in Turkey, you find them in Iran, Korea, and all over the world you have megalithic monuments. And the similarity that they have in form. Initially, you had the diffusionist theories which said that they had a center of origin from where they spread along various migratory routes of people and all that, which are discredited now. But considering, I feel that the level at which level at which the similarities exist cannot be explained away so easily. So maybe we need to revisit it. This is a thing that I will take up at the end if I have time after this one here. So the Indian megalith, the first report of a megalith in India was in 1823 by Babington, and that was in Kerala. And so in the nearly 200 years that have passed, we now know more than 3,000 megalithic sites all over India. So in general, the South Indian megaliths, they contain secondary burials of typically more than one individual. And a pottery fabric known as black and red ware is quite closely associated with it. And in many of them, but not all, certainly, you find iron objects, which has led to their association with the Iron Age increasingly. So to give you a kind of time frame to drape this facts on, the South Indian Neolithic happened around 3000 to 1200 BC. And the Iron Age is from 1200 to 500. And 1,000 years later is a period called the early historic. Now these are not absolute dates, but gives you a kind of a framework to put what I'm talking about in general. So where do they occur? Now you can see from the distribution by Robert Brubaker that most of them seem to occur in southern India, with considerable pockets in Vidarbha, in Kashmir, you can see here, in Jharkhand, and of course there's a practice of the northeastern megaliths are not being discussed in this particular lecture. And though people believe that they closely track the Iron Age, in fact, people we say Iron Age megalithic, so it's been so increasingly associated with it. But Kathleen Morrison had reanalyzed a piece of charcoal from Wheeler's 1947 excavations at Brahmagiri, and she got a date which is in the middle of the Neolithic. So we can wonder whether, you know, the origin of megalithism, if you can call that, if that is a word actually, was before the Iron Age or not. And so she says that, for example, that, you know, we can just think of them, megaliths, as not as a marker of a particular phase in human history or prehistory, but as features that and practices that were popular in different times at different places of the country. So I've been looking at megaliths in around 61 megalithic sites, and some of the clues, I'm looking at it as an architect more than anything else, how the monument was made and things like that. So when you look at the inside a dolmen, there's a play of light inside a dolmen at Hirabanakal. So you can see that the slab, the erect slab, which are called orthostats, they do not touch the heavy capstone at the top at every point. It's not like later architecture when they were properly finished plane and things like that. You have very rough edges to that, to the orthostats there. You can see the same thing. This is again at Hirabanakal. This is at Virajpet and Coorg. You can see that they're just touching at certain points and they transfer the load down to the thing. And also, if you look at these slab circles or the slab circle in Mallasandram, this one has fallen down. You can see the edges are not, they seem to be hammered rest by percussion, by hitting with another piece of stone or with a hammer, we do not know. So they do not, and if you look at the modern practice of splitting stones, this is at a granite quarry in Karkala, nearby Karkala. So what the practice, usually what is done is you take iron wedges like these and you hammer them at intervals along the line you want to split them, and by increasingly hammering it at intervals, the stone splits along the line of the wedges. Now this method will leave a telltale mark of these wedge marks, even in this small piece of stone here. If you're splitting bigger blocks, you have bigger wedges, really thick wedges. So when you look at a extends a site like Hiravanakal, there's a lot of clues. That it was a prehistoric site. There are no texts that remain, no inscriptions. But the techniques, it's veritably a workshop of stone working. And you have things like, you know, it seems to have been that they must have removed the bedrock by fire setting, a technique known as fire setting, where they heap fuel along the thing and set it on fire, and it cracks along certain lines. See, there's unused stone like this lying around in plenty at Hiravanakal. And there is a large boulder. We cannot imagine how they split this stone in the middle, right, like that. For example, if you look at this is one way they would have constructed this rough megaliths known, which were termed irregular polygonal chambers by Professor Sundara long ago. So you have the slabs lying here. One of the slabs has been propped up on this little stones there and converted into the chamber. So they seem to have used fire setting and not iron wedges. And if you compare it to stoneworking in later periods, if you look at Hampi, this is from Hampi. These two are from, this is a modern one and this is a ancient one from the Chalukyan period at in the Malaprabha Valley. And compare it with this, you do not find any trace of these wedge marks in Hiravanakal. So they don't seem to have used iron in the extraction of stone, at least. And in the very few instances where I have seen chisel marks on a dolmen, this one is at the one Virajpet dolmen. There seems to be a line of chisel marks here. And later, I found in an archaeological report that it's Colonel Mackenzie who actually opened it up by using these chisel marks or whatever. So it's a much later intervention you're seeing on this. So now from here, with this background, I'll take you to the same landscape that Hemant was telling you about, the Malaprabha Valley. The river Malaprabha originates at Kanakumbi in the Western Ghats and flows down and ultimately meets the river Krishna. So for around 25 kilometers before it meets Krishna, it passes through these low sandstone hills that you're seeing here, a valley maybe 8 to 10 kilometers at the widest. And along this are some of the most stupendous sites in ancient architecture that you can see. A little bit north of the place where it enters the valley is Badami. Roughly midway, where the river takes a loop towards the north, you have Pattadakal. And then you have Aihole, where the river leaves the valley. So we'll look at Badami. Like Hemant told you, it's like you have the Agastya Tirtha here. Pulakeshi, the first founder of the Badami Chalukyas, he dammed this area here and he converted this into a lake. All the runoff from here comes into that. And here you have the, I think the next slide will show you the closer view. So you have all the cave temples which have been scooped out of living rock in this part of the what's called the South Fort. And in the North Fort, you have majority of the structural monuments. In the east, you have the Bhutanatha complex and all that. So if you go wander into these cliffs out here and look westwards, this is the view you will see. So it's a beautiful place, and you can see this is where all the cave temples are. These are the structural temples, and this is the Bhutanatha. So though Badami is or the Malaprabha Valley's claim to fame is mostly the Chalukyan temple, like the this is another view from the south. And this is these are the rock cut temples. This cave number 4, the Jaina temple. And the rock cut architecture as well as the structural architecture, there's a Malagathi Shivalaya of the Vatapi Chalukyas. The human occupation there dates back to the Paleolithic at least. There's a Shidlafadi natural sandstone shelter where you have rock art and other antiquities that stretch back to the Paleolithic. And there is Mesolithic rock art at a place called Ranganatha Gudda. So basically, the human occupation there has been very ancient. And though there are no megaliths in Badami proper, the nearest is, I think, Gajendragad, where you have megaliths. You have in Pattadakal, this is when you go downriver, you come to Pattadakal, you have a place called Bachanagudda before you reach there, where you have, this is Bachanagudda, there's a Rashtrakuta period temple on this shoulder of the hill. And this is a granite passage chamber here, which is a kind of megalith. There's a passage grave built out of sandstone. This is the earlier one which I told you, the porthole dolmen. And Professor Sundara has told in his book on Pattadakal that probably this was what is remaining of a large field of megaliths which were there. You find this temple, this is inside the dolmen. When you look out on the shoulder, you see the later period temple here, Rashtrakuta period temple, Vachalingeshwara. And a little northwest of Pattadakal, you have this place called Huligemmanakolla, where in this rock shelter that you see out here, there's a beautiful set of Saptamatrikas from the Chalukyan period. And in the valley facing this rock shelter, you have many temples here, which are scattered around, small temples, some of them not very well finished. There is one particular temple which has an inscription to the right of this Dwarapala out here in Halagannada, which says that, which suggests that it is a sepulchral temple of, or at least a memorial temple of Vikramaditya II, the king who, the Chalukyan king, the penultimate one. So all the doubt that seems to exist in academic circles is whether it is Vikramaditya II who is commemorated here, but there's no doubt that it's a sepulchral or a memorial temple. So adding to the sepulchral connotations at this site, you also have this hero stone, which is sculpted on a, which is generally commemorating people who died valorous deaths or whatever. So here you have a person being commemorated. There's a detail of what you can see out here. There's cattle shown here. So this is probably a hero who died protecting cattle. So this is very close to the temple and the Vikramaditya II's alleged memorial temple. So I found that I'm not the first one to think about all these things. M.S. Mate and Chobana Gokhale of 1971 asked why there are so many temples in the Malaprabha Valley. And they have come up to the conclusion that this was a Tirtha where memorials, it was by the commemorative landscape that you were talking about. Has been shown here. So when you go to Pattadakal, normally you are taken, it's a World Heritage Site, and you look at the big temples, the Lokeshwara, the Trilokeshwara, Sangameshwara, and all that. But there are these little temples by side in a large number, which you see here. You can see the big ones here. You have Dravida as well as Nagara idiom of building here. And here you have a lot of these smaller temples, which are, you can see that they're just a linga, a garbhagriha, and a porch out here. Many of them have lost their walls. And this one, a beautiful small temple in which there is a linga and usually there's a nandi sitting outside here. This is almost like a dolmen, with this pothole dolmen. This looks like a capstone which has been put here. And the local masons actually refer to dolmens as Dabkal Gudi, which means a shrine, capstone shrine, you can interpret it as. And this particular little shrine, it's actually constructed the way a dolmen is made, like, you know, with the so-called interlocking system to prevent inward collapse or whatever, and built of single stones here. And then, I know I'm rushing you, we are rushing downriver to Aihole here now, where the river leaves the valley. And this is Aihole, the settlement of Aihole, with all the temples that Hemant has shown you. And then south of the settlement, here you have Meguthi temple, which he talked about, the Jain temple there. And Meguthi hill, there is a walled compound in which the Meguthi temple is there. And behind you have the megalithic site with a lot of dolmens there. So this is a Meguthi temple with the inscription of Revikirti, which allows us to date it to 634 CE. And behind, this is a temple with its walled compound. And in this plateau behind, you have plenty of dolmen, about 80, as he said. Some of them are crude like these. Some of them are properly, this is the largest one there, a slab dolmen, which you can see out here. And in Aihole, there are some other dolmens. Dolmen is struck me as strange in their form. One is near in the Galaganatha complex at Aihole. This is one of the Galaganatha group of temple, one of the temple group. And behind it, there's a historical photograph. This is the dolmen that they're talking about. There's a similar one at Mote Bennur, which I have not visited. And where does this Galaganatha dolmen come? So this is Aihole, this is Meguthi Hill, and this is the Ramalingeshwara Hill. There are two temples here. The Galaganatha complex is here, and the Ramalingeshwara complex is here. So this is the Ramalingeshwara. It's probably 11th century temple complex that you can see out here. And this is taken from the south. And this is the Galaganatha temple complex, which also has temples from Chalukyan era and later periods also. And this is a Galaganatha dolmen. So what struck me, you don't find dolmen standing on six legs in many places. It's not very common occurrence. So then I noticed that normally you do not find chisel marks on any of the megaliths that we're talking about. So you don't find any chisel marks on the capstone here. But on the legs, you do find a lot of chisel marks. All of them have, except one, all five of them have chisel marks on them. So, and then these two temples seem to be part of a large distribution of megaliths there. Behind in the south, you have this cairn with a couple of hero stones embedded on it. And there is this low dolmen, all this, and this little passage chamber here. This is all behind the temples there. And when I explored the hill further to the south, I found that there are many unreported megaliths also, like this cairn you can see out here. So much so that, and there are other shrines also distributed to the south of it. So it looks like an intermingling of shrines as well as dolmens in this entire area. See, this you can see is a low crude dolmen, and this is the shrine which you can see out here. And so this again shows you the Galaganatha temple complex in the background with a lot of dolmens in the foreground, the low crude kind of dolmens. So in Aihole, there seems to be three major sets of megalithic areas. This is the Aihole settlement. This is Meguthi Hill with all its dolmens. Here there is a megalithic site called Kyadigere, which Professor Sundara has reported in 1975, but they have been destroyed in 2008, totally, completely removed from them. There's not a single megalith surviving there. And here, behind here, this is a map that I'd plotted there. Subsequently, I found that for till the end of this hill, you have megalithic monuments which have been distributed there. So why did they, Gregory Chopin has hypothesized that many Buddhist stupa sites like Nagarjunakonda, Amravati and all that, they seem to have selected the site because it is a site of the proto-historical dead, the megalithic sites. I am suspecting something similar in this place when the agro-pastoral people who lived there had the dolmen building tradition, which was later on supplemented by the Chalukyan era building. So looking at the Galaganatha dolmen, on the hill behind, it's a low one. It's basically, you can see here, where it has been quarried away from here and raised in situ by propping it up on a couple of stones. And the capstone measures around 3.5 meters by 2 meters and varies from 15 to... It's a very rough thing produced by that. And if you look at the Galaganatha dolmen, the capstone is of similar size, you can see here. And the legs, like I told you, they have chisel marks, which you can see here. And the chisel marks are signature chisel marks of the Chalukyan. Now, how do I say that? It is because we have found quarries. I mean, recently in the Archaeological Survey of India and a couple of guides in Patadakala have found this. This is one of the quarries of the Chalukyans from the 8th century. You have inscriptions here. You have mason's marks. You have sketch studies, sculptures, and what has been interpreted as the attendance marks of the artisans there. And you can find actually this is a place, this lonely windswept hilltop is where the Chalukyan artisans actually conceived and executed their work. You can see the study of a beautiful image of Mahishasanamardhini, which is there in Papanatha temple in Patadakal. The exact study of that you can find on a rock surface in the quarry. So anyway, coming to our story, this is a view of the temples from the quarry. And yeah, these are the typical Chalukyan wedge marks which you can see out here. And if you wander around there for a long time, they have actually left enough clues to show how they have worked. If you want to split a stone along the line is marked, the wedge hole points are identified, then they mark out the wedge, the outlines of it, and then they scoop out that thing, then they bang it in with wedges and split the stone. Now the thing to see here is that they do not have rectangular wedge holes, they are elliptical, lenticular in shape. And you can see that here, the lenticular shape, you can contrast it with the quarry marks of the illegal quarriers who quarry there now. They have rectangular ones. So you can see to say that they are Chalukyan, in the incomplete Shukanasa of the Galaganatha temple at Pattadakal, you can see this elliptical looking, inside this area, you can see that these marks are here. And at every side, this is at Rahulfadi, these two are at Virupaksha temple in Pattadakal, this is at Mahakota, and this is at Huligamanakolla. You can see that all the chisel marks are elliptical. And compare it with this at Hampi, much later period, of course, but they have their wedge holes are all square. And you can see that your details of the thing, stone after it has split and before it is split and things like that. So you can say for quite confidently that these wedge holes are that of the Chalukyan artisans. And so basically, this monument would have looked like this, a low thing propped up on small stones. For some purpose, which we do not know, the temple builders have raised it on these six legs. And Professor Srinivas Padigar has told me that during the clearance, the Lajagauri image, which is now in the Aihole Museum, was found kept on top of this capstone when it was. So I don't know what that means, but I just supplied that bit of information. So which brings to the question that rest of the temples of the Galaganatha group, this one actually looks like a porthole dolmen. So are they also sepulchral? Are they memorial in nature, this large number? And M.S. Marte and Shobhana Gokhale seem to think so. So now, the idea that memorial temples can exist are not so fanciful. You have memorial temples of the Adi Shankaracharyas at Sringeri anyway. And now to rush ahead to another kind of monument. Okay, this is to show that I have the backing of stalwarts in the field to tell this thing. Venkatramanaya has said that the connection of the temple with the graveyard therefore seems to be intimate and ancient. And Stella Kramrisch has also suggested that the prototype of the flat roof shrine is a dolmen. Now to go to another geographical area, the Krishnagiri region in Tamil Nadu. Here you have this place called Mallasandram.
you have the hillsides, you have so many dolmens that they even turn up on Google Earth images. They are in three clusters, like you can see out here. And I'll go, this is one of the clusters, the northern cluster, the western cluster. And if we look at one particular dolmen here, you can see, to cut it close, you have a dolmen in the center, okay, which is surrounded by a set of closely fitting stone slabs. And originally, it was covered with a mound of rubble, like you can see here.
This site has received a lot of attention from treasure seekers, even in recent times. The day before we went, one of the dolmens was dug out by people.
So all this mound has been removed. And you can see here that this is the other side, view from the other side looking at the dolmen. They've erected a kind of a masonry wall here to support it, to prevent it from collapsing outwards. And this is a detail of the closely fitting stone slabs on the periphery. You have huge blocks of stone kept to hold them in place.
This is showing the neck of what I would call a proto-stupa.
And you can see the rest of it here. So I have measured this one, and I have done this.
This is how it would have looked like originally.
You have this is a cross-section through it. You have the dolmen here with the porthole, and you have the masonry wall built outside to keep it firm. And this is a closely fitting stone slab circle which comes out there. And when it was originally filled, it would look like a mound. So by looking at different megalithic sites, like, you know, this is a place called Buddhana Jeddu near here, near in Udupi, towards Mookambika temple when you go. So there's a small cairn. When they're very small, you don't need to contain them. They hold their shape by their own. But when you have them really large, like at Champa in Vidarbha, where you have really large, 20 meters in diameter, yeah, got it. So you need to put large stone circle around it to contain it. And then when you want to make a bit more higher, a prominent one, like the one at Bandipur, one of the place called Chikkalchetti, you drive in slabs on their ends in a circle to contain them, like another place in Kaveri Wildlife Sanctuary. Here you can see the stone slab that have been driven in on end at an angle, and then you can raise a larger mound there, more prominent monument. And so, okay, just making it sound very unromantic, this same principle that you find at any construction site, I would call it the structural requirements of containment, is what dictates the form of this monument. And it's only one step from there, from this kind of a thing, to look at the large stupa. This is the one at Kanaganahalli, near Sannathi. And the drum of the stupa lends itself to embellishment like this, and things like that. So, and then ultimately, to just finish off, I've been telling you that megaliths are a worldwide phenomenon. So now by re-examining some images of monuments that are in really different parts of the world, like whether this Anta in Portugal or the multiple hood stone you find in Kodakkal Parambu in Kerala, or this looks even more, this one is in Turkey, and this is one at Kandansheri in Thrissur. Look at the entrance portal, and when the way in which they've detailed it looks like that. So I'm not suggesting that we go back to the diffusionist theories, but I think like Professor Upinder Singh said in her keynote address, that between these two extremes of completely independent origins and that, you know, everything originated and migrated with people and all that, one should re-examine scenarios where maybe, you know, the modified diffusionist theories or whatever, where spread of ideas could have happened. So this again, it's at the stone alignment at Hanam Sagar, which I showed you in one of the first slides, and the stone alignment at Karnak, which Professor Sundara pointed out in his 1975 book. So I'll end with this. I found that the perfect apology in James Ferguson's book, where he says that, you can read it, that thing of being open to criticism for bringing up some of these outlandish sounding ideas. So yes, in the end, I would like to tell you that I was a recipient of the Achyutrao Memorial Fellowship for the year 2007. That marked the beginning of what has been a very wonderful journey for me. So I would really like to thank them for the endowment which they gave me in 2007, the beginning of all these adventures. And thank you all.